This is a lecture of Pharmacology, Part 1, and in this lecture we're going to cover the basics of pharmacology. We'll look at drug receptors, and we're going to look at the drug cycle. As we begin pharmacology basics, let me start with this. Drugs, they don't create any new responses in the body, but they change an activity that is happening. But how do they know where to go? Well, most drugs, they're created to bind to a receptor to cause an effect. A receptor is a specialized protein on a cell that drugs bind or stick to. A medication is like a key looking for the right lock or the right receptor. Once the receptors are activated, they trigger a specific response in the body, like the release of neurotransmitters or hormones. There are two different types of drugs. Agonists are drugs that stimulate and activate the receptor. I think of agonists as it's a go. They turn a response on. Antagonists attach to a receptor, but they block the reaction or the response. So here's one of my tips for learning pharmacology. We're just talking about receptors. So as you begin your study of pharmacology, I recommend that you pay attention to the action of a drug. What kind of activity is it altering? Is it turning a receptor off or on? I find that if I understand this drug action, then many times the side effects will make sense. This will make it easier for you to understand and learn these medications. And then as you study these medications and you're studying side effects, you're not trying to just memorize a random list of side effects. Here's an example. Aspirin blocks an enzyme, COX-1. One job of COX-1 in our bodies is to protect the stomach mucosa. So, now we block COX-1 with aspirin, what would you suspect the side effects would be? GI distress and GI bleed. Does that make sense? So pharmacokinetics is what the body does to the drug. We call this the drug cycle. This cycle has four main phases: absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. Remember ADME. This is the drug cycle. So when a medication is ingested, applied, or injected, it enters the bloodstream. This is absorption. The second phase is distribution, which is the delivery of a medication to the target, to that target site, after it's gotten into the bloodstream. Metabolism, or a fancy name is biotransformation, is how the medication is broken down or transformed so that it can be removed from the body. Excretion is the elimination of the drug out of the body. Again, absorption is how the medication gets into the bloodstream from where it was given. For example, you take a pill and it goes into the stomach or intestine and then into the bloodstream. So medications are given in three ways. Enteral route of medication are given in the GI tract. This is PO, rectal, and an NG or a G-tube. Now, some pharmacology information sources define parenteral administration as anything non-oral, but you know it's usually interpreted as relating to injecting directly into the body, bypassing the skin and the mucous membranes. The common parenteral routes are intramuscular, subcutaneous, and intravenous. Percutaneous absorption happens through unbroken skin, so percutaneous routes are inhalation, sublingual, topical, and transdermal. How fast a medication is absorbed depends on how it's given, topical or systemic. The speed of absorption depends on the route of administration. Meds that are given IV or intravenous are absorbed the fastest. Oral and transdermal or topical are the slowest. You know, it's interesting to note that liquid medications act faster than pills when they're given orally because pills must first be broken down and then be absorbed. You know, intramuscular injections, they act fairly fast too, because the muscles have a rich supply of blood to which gives fast entry into the blood circulation. Solubility, pH, the concentration of medication, length of contact, age, food, and depth of breathing all affect medication absorption. The more soluble a medication is in fat or lipids, the easier it is to absorb through the stomach into the bloodstream. The lower the pH, or the more acidic a medication is, the easier it is absorbed in the stomach. Length of contact affects absorption. Take topical medications, for instance. The longer the medication remains on the skin, the greater the absorption will be. Age can also affect absorption. The young and the old absorb more medication through the skin than healthy adults do. When we apply a topical medication, then, it's usually applied in a very thin layer. Food affects absorption. Food slows down the absorption of medications. On the other hand, stomach acid facilitates absorption. Therefore, medication is absorbed faster when acid in the stomach is increased. Depth of breathing affects absorption of inhaled respiratory medications. The deeper you breathe in, the more medication you inhale. You know, as healthcare professionals, we can take steps to facilitate absorption. We can make sure the skin is clean and dry if we're applying a topical medication. If we're giving an IM injection, a tattooed arm could hinder absorption because of the decreased blood flow caused by scar tissue and tattoo ink, so we might want to find another site for injection. So distribution is the delivery of the drug to the site that it's needed, to that target zone, after it's been absorbed into the bloodstream. Sometimes it's hard for a drug to travel from the blood to an organ because of physiological barriers that we have in our bodies. These physiological barriers allow nutrients and certain chemicals to pass through, but not other substances, including medication. The blood-brain barrier helps protect our brain. This can, however, though, create a challenge for pharmaceutical companies when they want to create drugs that are needed to affect our brain, such as Alzheimer's medications. When we administer medications that crosses this barrier, though, we must be aware that these medications have the risk of creating serious side effects and permanent damage. Psychotropic drugs are an example of medications that cross this blood-brain barrier. The blood-placental barrier helps to filter drugs from passing from the mother to the fetus, which protects the fetus. Alcohol, cocaine, and some over-the-counter medications, and many prescription medications, can easily cross this blood-placental barrier and cause harm. So it's recommended that women who are pregnant check with their healthcare providers before taking any medication. The blood-testicular barrier protects the male reproductive organs from toxins that can damage sperm. This barrier can make male reproductive diseases difficult to treat. Metabolism is also known as biotransformation, and is the process where medication is gradually transformed to a less active or inactive form. Most metabolism takes place in the liver by means of enzymes. So would it make sense that if a patient has liver disease, the possibility of toxicity would be increased? You know, assessing the patient's lab work, like a liver panel, may give the nurse a view of liver function. The kidneys and intestines also help with medication metabolism. You know, as a side note, here's the thing about insulin. If it's given by mouth, usually it's virtually useless because stomach acids break it down to an inactive form before it can be absorbed into the bloodstream or even reach the liver. This is why insulin must be given by injection. Once the medication is acted in the body, it's excreted. Kidneys are the main organs of excretion. Saliva, sweat glands, lungs, and breasts also excrete small amounts. Excretion is important because it ensures that waste products are removed and medications don't build up or we have accumulation. Accumulation refers to a buildup of medication in the body leading to illness or toxicity. When we talk about toxicity, that refers to how poisonous or harmful a substance can be. In the context of pharmacology, drug toxicity occurs when a person has accumulated too much of a drug in his bloodstream, and this can lead to adverse effects within the body. That concludes part one. If you have any questions, let me know. Bring them to the Farm Cafe or to the classroom.